Welcome back, rebels, freedom fighters, mercenaries. I'm ChewBubba01, and today I'm going to give a quick review and my near miss of 100% for the game Just Cause 3. I do like to 100% games, but I haven't always been consistent on documenting these milestones, or if I have, you know, they get deleted or shared on social media and then forgotten. And I don't get it here on this game, but as I get older, I seem to care less about grinding away trying to get that 100%. Just to be clear from the start, I have not played Just Cause 1 or Just Cause 2, so 3 was my entry into this world, and at first it seemed like I was missing out on information, since I didn't know who anybody was or why they were important to the story. This is about a fictional country, Medici, that is being ruled by an evil dictator. And you play as Rico Rodriguez, who I can't tell if he's a freedom fighter or mercenary or even a science experiment. I'm not really sure. Anyway, he's being called in to help the rebels overthrow the evil dictator. And that's how you spend most of your time in the game, is overthrowing the dictator. And to do that, you have to liberate towns and military bases and eventually whole provinces from his military control. And you do this by blowing everything up, which is my favorite gameplay mechanic in this whole thing. In fact, blowing up stuff is so much fun, every gas station I passed became a potential target, and blowing them up doesn't even advance the game at all, but it's still like super, super fun.
Perfect parking space.
Well done, Rico.
Best idea of that all day. Perfect parking space.
You've inspired us to think back on foot. Viva la revolution!
Best idea of that all day.
Once towns and bases are liberated, skill-based challenges are unlocked. And I knew that they were going to be my Achilles heel. So I did not set the bar high for myself here. I decided early on that if I could get at least 3 stars or gears in this game on all the challenges, that would be good enough. And any more than 3 would just be gravy. I also knew that setting 3 out of 5 would affect my 100% completion rate of the game. And you'll see that later in the video. be honest, at first I ignored the challenges completely and just liberated places and continued the main story. But someone I know told me that completing them would give you perks that makes the game easier. So I went back and started doing all the challenges that I skipped. In fact, much later I figured out that some of the challenges could even be cheesed a little bit, and I could get an easy 5-star or 5-gear rating. Some airplane challenges could be done with a helicopter instead, which gave me more control. Or a driving challenge could be done with a faster car, or instead an off-road car that handles dirt roads better. And then some challenges could be completely subverted, like this sniper challenge. Instead of using the sniper, I looked around and I saw an armed chopper, hopped in, and blasted my way to 5 gears. Or this tank challenge, where I did nearly the same trick. So a little cleverness goes a long way in this game. When liberating towns and bases, I tried to get as many anti-aircraft launchers as possible, because even if I die, they remain under my control when I respawn. And then you don't have to worry about being blasted by helicopters as the heat level increases. In fact, when the heat level gets high enough and the baddies send in a tank, you just hijack the tank. And if you run out of ammo and weapons locker is not nearby, just killing yourself will cause you to respawn with full ammo with no penalty. But a couple times the game decided I needed to respawn across the map, which was kind of annoying. And since I'm now thinking about glitches, there were very few glitches in Just Cause 3. It crashed maybe twice in the whole playthrough. And if you played Ark, then you know you expect to crash nearly every day. But the most annoying thing would be traveling in a car a long distance, you know, 8 or more kilometers, which can take 20 minutes or more. And then the car would just abruptly vanish and leave me standing in the road. And that happened a couple of times. And one of the times was when I was in a car that I was trying to collect, which was super frustrating. I also had to contend with my lack of skill. You need to be good at using all of the vehicles and all of the weapons, as well as tethering and parachuting and tethering while parachuting and, of course, wing gliding. Over time, I got pretty good at a lot of vehicles, but planes always made me nervous, especially the jets. I would constantly oversteer and end up slamming them into the ground. And I also tend to oversteer when wing gliding, but I did get okay at it eventually. But still, I would face plant on the ground a lot. As far as the story goes, it's very simple, kind of dumb. And the voice casting is confusing. Rico is clearly of Hispanic origin. The villain is also, at least seems to be of Hispanic descent. The terrain, though, looks like it might be a mix of Spain and Italy. And a lot of the towns and provinces, their names have an Italian feel to them. A whole lot of people in the streets, though, sound American. And some of the higher level enemy troops have Australian or even European accents. And so all of this left me a little confused. Where was this happening, you know? If Avalanche and Square Enix were intending to be globally ambiguous, they win. If not, then I don't know what's going on, and I wondered if all this was addressed in, like, Just Cause 1 and 2, but I didn't play them, so I don't know. And then if you think too hard about it, is Rico really a hero? Before you liberate someplace, there are guys in trucks patrolling the towns, you know, or their base or whatever, with machine guns. And after you liberate it, there are different guys in different trucks patrolling with machine guns. Not to mention all the damage to the infrastructure you caused when liberating the place. Destroying electrical substations, transformers, fuel supplies. All that has to be doing great things to their economy. But I tried not to think about that too much. Overall, even though the story is weak and downright silly at times, like when you hitch a ride on a missile, this game is amazingly fun. It's not too difficult, and it has a lot of variety in the challenges and options available to the player, especially in the late game. Plus, like I've mentioned several times, blowing up stuff is super fun. It's so fun, there's even an option in the game that lets you reoppress a location so you can blow everything up and liberate it again, just for funsies. So as far as the 100% goes, I got close with a 96%. I liberated the whole country, town by town, military base by military base. Everything liberated is blue on the map. Anything still under the control of the dictator or his forces are in red. So you can see in the menu that 100% of the provinces and such are liberated. The missions and challenges are only 90%, and this is the only score I have below 100, since I was only shooting for 3 gears out of a possible 5. Now, to be fair, once I figured out that you could cheese some of the challenges, I think if I wanted to sit and grind out 5 stars on all of these, I could probably do it. But I'm happy with 3 out of 5. I got 100% of the garage blueprints, which means I found every vehicle in the game and took them to special locations to collect them. That includes the elusive news helicopter, which was kind of frustrating, and the Batman-inspired boat that I had to ride down a mountain valley. And even though it didn't count, I even stumbled across the fabled snowman on the beach.
So, we meet again, Mr. Snowman.
I got 100% of the collectibles, which was pretty easy with the map and a helicopter. And the map and helicopter also made getting 100% of the dictator's audio tapes pretty easy work as well. My stats, though, are not that impressive, but I do find it amusing that it seems no matter what game I'm playing, my accuracy is always around 35%. There is one thing on the leaderboard that's worth showing. The same guy that told me to do the challenges also mentioned a hidden soapbox derby car. And I found it, and I coasted nearly 7 kilometers in it. And so I was pretty happy about that.
Rico, can you help? Let me explain.
Do you want to try it?
Got your help?
I'm going to put you again, eh?
I don't remember the last time.
Thank you.
Well, that pretty much brings us to the end, and while this is not a thinking man's game, it is still super, super fun. I'm definitely going to keep my hands on this game for when I just feel the need for mindless destruction. Up next is a game that someone has been begging me to play for a few years, Subnautica. Until then, I have to put some gas in the car and do some more community renewal projects. So thanks for watching, and I'll catch you next time.